Good morning.
Good morning.
It's fall, and we really are grateful for this day the Lord has given us, and we're glad for each of you that are here, those that are inside and those that are outside, sitting in the cars listening on the radios. We're happy for everyone. And we just want to thank the Lord for giving us this day to honor Him and worship Him. We have several visitors here today, so we want all of you to feel welcome and feel the presence of the Lord as we worship Him today. Before we start, I want to go over some announcements. There are several that are printed in the bulletin that I hope you will read through them and keep them in mind this week. Let me just highlight a few of these. I wanted to mention that today is our annual Faith Promise Mission Sunday. So we're going to hear from a couple of missionaries by video a little bit later on in the service, and we'll explain more about that when the time comes. And then at the end of the service, we're going to be taking up what we call our Faith Promises offering, which those yellow cards in the, well, some of them are yellow, some of them are green, in the bulletin today. Every year, at this time of the year, we ask our people to pray about and ask the Lord what He would have you do in terms of making a financial commitment to support mission work over the coming year. And so that's what those cards are for. And again, we'll be talking about that more at the end of the service. And then I did want to mention a little bit about this announcement regarding Monroe and Ray Lynn working with the teenagers. They had planned to do this back, well, I think it was supposed to start the first Sunday of April. And you know what was going on the first Sunday of April. We weren't even meeting inside. And we started, I think, that following Sunday on Easter with doing parking lot services, and then eventually started coming inside. But so we're going to try to begin next Sunday with them working with the teens, teaching a Bible lesson and other activities. This will occur at the same time as the junior church. The youth will be in the gymnasium over in the fellowship hall, while the younger kids are in the front part of the building. And that will take place every other Sunday so that the teens can be in here every other Sunday. So keep that in mind and spread the word about that. And we hope that the teenagers will be able to participate with that. I wanted to also just mention here that for those that are watching the service on Facebook or on YouTube, we will be mailing out as many as possible. Yes?
Hey, they can't get on the radio.
Okay. Ask one of the fellas out there or somebody to see if they can help you find it on the radio.
I need to find out if everybody else is getting it first. If they are, then...
Well, I know some of them were because I could hear the music playing out there when I was walking around.
This is just them.
So it might just be their radio isn't set right. I don't know. We don't want anybody missing out. But we are going to try to send out bulletins to as many of the people that we can think of who aren't here today and are watching online so that you can also participate in the Faith Promise commitments, and then you can mail those back to the church. And then I just wanted to mention as well There's a notice in the bulletin here about this, but we all have suffered a great loss over the last 7 weeks. We have lost 5 of our church people. That's the worst that it's been in the 11 years that I've been here. We're very feeling the effects of that. We're very sad about that. But it occurred to me and to my wife, we were talking about it, that just in case you, in your conversation with anybody, just in case you hear anyone implying that we've been hit with the COVID and that's the reason for those deaths, kindly correct them and let them know that none of them have been related to COVID. I think all 5 of them tested negative. So I don't know what the county statistics will reveal, but I know what I was told. So if you could just kind of squelch any fears that might be perpetrated or going around in that regard, I think that would be a great help. I don't know if it's affected the attendance or not, but just in case, maybe we can help alleviate those fears. There are some people that Chris and I were just going through our folder this week. There are some people who have gone through the background clearances that are necessary in order to work with children and youth, and those have to be renewed every 5 years. And so we have about 6 of us, my wife and I included, that ours expired this year, need to be renewed. So I'll try to let you know who you are, and we'll put an announcement in next week's bulletin, just a reminder of the website where you go to do that and get those updated. I also want to mention that a week from tomorrow, on October the 19th, is the last day to register to vote in this November election. And so if you are not registered to vote, I would urge you to do that. We have some forms on the table out here. Make sure that you mail them soon enough to get there before next Monday, or go drop them off by hand in person at the Board of Elections. And I guess I would recommend the same thing. I know I would. I guess I'm not guessing about it. I know I would recommend, if you're planning to do a mail-in ballot so you don't have to stand in line at the polls, I would urge you to go deliver that ballot in person at the Board of Elections.
Absolutely.
That way you'll know that it got there. I think, didn't we have some dishes?
Yeah, they're out.
Okay, the dishes for anyone that prepared food for the funeral dinner this week are on the bench out in the lobby, so you can pick those up after church. And then I have a thank you card here that I was asked to read. Whether you kept us in your thoughts and prayers, sent lovely arrangements, gave a memorial donation, or helped out in any way, our love and kindness brought us great comfort. Your love and kindness brought us great comfort and will always be remembered, the Wood family. Are there any other announcements that I should have made that we've overlooked today?
I need to meet with the ladies after church.
Okay.
Wait on me, because I'll get back here.
Chris will be coming back over here after Junior Church. She'd like to meet with several ladies. And this is in regards to the benefit dinner that's mentioned in the bulletin here. This friend of the Fosters, Bill Watson, that passed away not too long ago, just, 3 weeks ago maybe, or something like that, from cancer. There's still a number of medical bills that they didn't have covered, that wasn't covered by their insurance, that are outstanding. And so Crystal wanted to do this dinner to raise money to help the family.
We just need cakes. That's all we're doing.
And the ladies of the church are doing cakes for that dinner, and that's what Chris needs to talk to you about after church today. All right. Let's bow our heads for prayer, and then Chris will come and lead us in our call to worship and our songs. Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you for your promise that you will be with us wherever we gather in your name. And we thank you for everyone that is here today. And we ask, O Lord, that your presence would come and minister to us, that your Holy Spirit would speak to our hearts and draw us close to you and help us to walk with you today and hear your voice through the word. And Lord, challenge us in the message and in the information that we'll be sharing today, that our hearts will be challenged to be busy about our Master's work and the kingdom work and spreading the gospel of Jesus. We ask that everything in this service bring glory to you and be for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. If you want to take out your bulletins, you'll find that this morning's call to worship comes from the book of Psalms 138, verses 4 and 5. We're going to go ahead and read that out aloud together in unison. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, when they hear the words of your mouth. Yes, they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory. Glory is great. Amen. Amen. We're going to start the singing off this morning with this first chorus, number 445. People need the Lord.
I am
wouldn't mind standing for those of you that can, and let's go ahead and sing number 441, Rescue the Perishing.
Thank you. Our reading this morning, our scripture reading, is in Psalm chapter 96, if you want to turn there. Chapter 96 in the book of Psalms, beginning with verse 1. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. He shall judge the peoples righteously. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar in all its fullness. Let the field be joyful and all that is in it. Then all the trees of the woods will rejoice before the Lord. For he is coming to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. Amen.
Thank you, Kenton. We're going to go to prayer at this time. As you can see on the prayer list in the bulletin, we have a number of people to be thinking about and praying for each day. And just want to mention that on the list of names here, Mary Blair there at the very top, Virginia said that she is home from the hospital where she had gone the other day for a blood clot. And we want to keep praying for her. Of course, she's battling with cancer, and we want to just lift her up before the Lord. Marlene Smith's mother, Blanche Banani, came through her hip surgery. For those who didn't know, if you're not on the prayer chain, she had fallen and broke her hip. And she had to have surgery, was it Thursday or Friday? But she came through the surgery, and the main concern they had was that she does have a weak heart, and they were just concerned about that. But so far, she's coming along, and we just want to continue praying for her. Keep praying for Milford, who's recovering from surgery that he had 7 or 8 weeks ago now, 7 weeks, I think. On down the list, Norm Turner will be starting chemotherapy this Thursday. So we want to pray for Norm and just ask the Lord to give him strength and help. And then keep praying for Bob Vodder and Diana. We announced last Sunday that he had decided to get enrolled with hospice, and we certainly want to keep praying for them. Virginia told me that her granddaughter-in-law is still in the hospital. She had been released and then had to go back. Her pancreas is still inflamed, and she just needs the Lord's help and his touch in her life. And then also I wanted to mention not only the Wood family, we're glad that Karen and her daughter Susan are here today, and it's nice to have them here. We certainly mourn with them, Sam's death, but we are grateful that he's with the Lord. And
honey, it's Janet. You said Karen.
Oh, did I say Karen?
You did.
Oh, wife's in. It's Janet. Thank you. And then I also wanted to mention Karen Campbell is on the list of bereaved families here. She passed away. I forget what day it was, but that is the niece of Larry McCloskey. And we certainly want to pray for their family and ask the Lord to touch them, as well as all of these other ones that have recently lost loved ones, that the Lord would somehow provide comfort and peace and strength to every one of them. Cleve Ettinger came through his surgery and recovering well. They're actually here today out in the parking lot. We're glad that they're able to be here. And he told me that he felt pretty good this morning and probably the best day so far that he's had. So we're glad that he's getting stronger and feeling better. Are there other requests that we've overlooked that we or didn't know about that need to be mentioned this morning? Francis.
I was thankful that the Lord blessed our president and he came through his
surgery. Yes. Yes. Amen. Thank the Lord for his touch for President Trump and Melania, and we want to. And then I do want to mention that we need to be praying for the election that's coming up and asking God to just superintend the whole process and get glory to his name. All right. How about unspoken requests? You want to represent a burden by an upraised hand? All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and as we pray, let me just mention one other thing here. I was going to mention it later, but I got on Facebook this morning, and since this is a missionary service today, we follow Mike and Donna Brown, or Mike Brown on Facebook, who was just here this, in fact, the last indoor service we had in March was with Mike Brown, missionary speaker from Bolivia. And Mike had a thing on Facebook this morning asking people to pray for Bolivia because they are having a presidential election next Sunday, the 18th. And he said their presidential election is every bit as crucial, if not more, than the election in the U.S. this year. So we need to be praying for Bolivia and their presidential election next Sunday, that God would have his way in their country as well. Let's pray together and lift our voices to the Lord. Father, we thank you that you have given us this privilege to come to you in prayer. You have invited us to come boldly to the throne of grace. That doesn't mean with arrogance, but it means to come with confidence that we know you're on the throne. We know that you're almighty and all-powerful, you're all-knowing and all-wise. You have everything in your control, and you have not surrendered your authority to anyone else. We're glad today that we can call upon you as our Father in heaven. And we know that you care for us as your children. We may not understand everything that comes our way. We may not understand, Lord, how you are working or what you are doing. But, oh Lord, the Bible tells us that your ways are higher than our ways, and your thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And there's no way that we finite human beings can understand infinite wisdom and infinite knowledge and infinite power. And Lord, we just want to bow before you this morning in our hearts and acknowledge that you are worthy to be honored and praised and glorified. You're worthy to be worshipped. You're worthy to be served. You're worthy to be obeyed, O Lord. And we're glad that you are God and not us. And we're glad that you know all the things that need to be known about this world and all around this world. And Lord, we're willingly trusting in you today and leaning on you today because we know that you're the only one that can help us in our great time of need. We thank you for everyone that is here, and we know, dear Lord, that every one of us have brought private burdens on our hearts along with us today, things that we're weighed down by, things that we're concerned about. We pray that your Spirit would work and touch us and help us in our lives, in our families, in our jobs, or whatever the circumstances might be. We just pray that the Spirit of the Lord would have your way and intervene and destroy the works of the devil and everything that he would try to ruin and tear down. Lord, we pray for those who need healing in their bodies. You know every one of them and what they're going through. You understand their suffering. You understand the physical problems that they face. And many of them on our prayer list have terminal illnesses, Lord. And we just pray that you would touch them today. We just ask, oh Lord, that you would lay your healing hand upon each and every one. We thank you for Ann Redfoot being here today, Lord, and how you've helped her so far. And we just pray that you would lay your hand on her this morning. And every one of us, oh Lord, that we would just sense your presence. Be with those who need comfort and your peace and guidance and your presence, Lord, as they go through the time of grief and sorrow over the loss of loved ones. You know the pain that they feel in their soul. And you know, dear Lord, those days and those hours that seem worse than others. And we pray that you would slip in beside them during every time of those circumstances, Lord, and help them to understand that you are right there carrying them and ministering to them by your grace. Lord, we pray that you would remember our nation today. We pray that you would have your way in this election in November. We pray that you would have your right of way, put down all of the forces of darkness and wickedness and evil. We know, dear Lord, that the enemy is trying his best to steer our nation away from biblical values, away from godly values. The devil is trying to steer our nation away from righteousness, Lord. And we just pray that you would have your way and raise up righteous rulers, as your word says. Because whenever the righteous rule, there is peace, there is gladness among the people. And Father, we just ask your will to be done. Bless those that are in authority, Lord. Give them wisdom from heaven. Help them to walk with you and follow your will, not the will of man, oh God. We do pray for the election in Bolivia, as Mike Brown asked us to do. You know the situation there. And we pray, oh God, in every part of the world, that you would overrule the powers of darkness, that you would have your right of way, that the kingdom of God would be lifted up and expanded, Lord, and we would sense your presence. Have your way throughout this service. We think of our missionaries, and as we're emphasizing that message today and our need to be actively involved and Lord, to participate in the spreading of the gospel, we pray that you would just work your will in each one of their lives and give them help and strength from above as they spread the gospel and teach others about Jesus. We'll give you the glory for everything that is accomplished, Lord, because you are truly worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, the children may be excused to go to junior church. We imported a couple of Ohioans this weekend for our junior church. Chris and I had gone to her nephew's wedding out in the state of Indiana. The wedding was in Indianapolis, and so on the way back home yesterday, we were invited to stop in Columbus and pick up a couple of kids and bring them with us. So we were certainly happy to do that. This morning, I've announced a few times in the bulletin and leading up to today, and let me just say this, I know we have several people that are away today that normally would be here, And I feel badly that they're not here to be involved in this service. But because of the coronavirus and the restrictions on travel, at least international travel, a lot of times during this event that we do every fall, we've been able to have either missionaries that are coming home from the field or native missionaries from other countries that visit here. The Fellowship of Bible Churches, which our church is a part of, always has a like an administrative board meeting in October or late September. And some of the times there are native pastors or native missionaries from other countries that will come home or come to the States, I should say, for that board meeting. And that makes it possible then for me to try to schedule them to come here for our Faith Promise Sunday. Well, obviously that wasn't possible this year. None of those individuals that work in other countries or live in other countries are able to come to the U.S. yet because of travel restrictions. And so I thought, well, you know, we have so much advantage these days with internet and technology, and every time I try to work with technology, it just reminds me of how little I know. But I sent an email to Genson Charlot, who is down in Haiti. He is an elder in the Fellowship of Bible Churches. And then I also sent an email to William Udotong, who is Nigerian. And Genson is a native of Haiti, and William is a native of Nigeria. Both of them have been here in the past, a few years back. And so I sent email messages to both of those men and asked them if they would record a 10 to 15 minute video of them speaking to us and upload it to YouTube so that I could access it on the internet and play it for you this morning. So they did do that, and I'm going to go back in just a moment and play those videos for us this morning. But before I do that, I just want to tell you, you'll have to listen real carefully, because neither one of them, well, let me say it this way, both of them are speaking English as their second language, or maybe their third language. I don't know for sure how many languages they speak. So they definitely have an accent, and it's not always real easy to hear what they're saying. So just do your best, and I've listened to it. Well, the entire thing at least once, and I've listened to portions of it more than once, and I'm going to listen again today, so I'll try to make sure I'm picking things up so that if you have any questions about something they said, maybe I can answer that. But it's a way of getting really the next best thing to having them here and hearing what they have to say about their work and what God is doing. And obviously there's not a lot that can be packed into. I think each one of them sent a video that's about 12 minutes or so. So there's not a whole lot that can be said in 12 minutes, but at least it'll give us a little bit of a flavor for their burden and their work. Now Genson will mention this later on in his presentation, but let me just say this before we start. When Genson and his wife Claudia were here before, he had just recently planted a fellowship church in Haiti in the city of Cap-Haitien, and there's another couple that has been to this church for missionary services years ago, Matt and Stacy Ayers, who were in Haiti. Haiti, and he eventually became the president of Emmaus Seminary, which is a school that's affiliated with One Mission Society, OMS, and the organization Tim Bell is with, and other people that we've had here. Well, this year, earlier, Matt Ayers went to another seminary in Mississippi to become the president there, and Genson Charlow was appointed by the board to become the new president of Emmaus Seminary and University there in Cap Haitien, Haiti. And he had gotten his doctorate from Asbury Seminary over a year ago, I think, and has been teaching at that school for 12 years. But now he is the president. So in addition to pastoring a church and he's really trying to oversee several different churches for the fellowship in Haiti. Now he's added on to that the president of the school. So I'm sure he's very busy. But I just wanted to mention that before we start. So let me go back and I don't know, last night, pretty late, I was here trying to make sure these were going to work. I still don't know if they're going to work right. So if we have a little bit of a glitch, just bear with me.
Brothers and sisters of Wayside Community Church. Thank you, Pastor Lester. Thank you, Sister Grace, for having me with you today on your special mission day. I thank God that I can be with you even through electronic and even through this video. I would love to be with you. Claudia and I would love to be with you in person, but traveling, as you all know, is almost impossible everywhere in the world today. So I'm glad, I thank God for this opportunity to be with you on your special day today. So I think you would be very interested to hear how things are in Haiti with COVID-19. And you know, as Haiti, we are so vulnerable. And the predictions were very, very scary, very gloomy for us in Haiti. We normally have no more than 200 intensive care hospital beds. We only have 200 beds available in our intensive care hospital for a population of over 11 million people. We have no electricity, no ventilation machines, no proper sanitization system, no infrastructure. Really, we do not have those kind of things in place to respond to the demands of COVID-19. So we were looking at COVID-19 as a giant killer that will come and finish us up. But all that we could do as a church, we could pray, and we were praying. We prayed 24/7. We prayed for 40 days. We fasted. We pray as a church. We call everybody to pray, and we pray. And we had time to pray. We didn't have anything else to do with our time, but we had time to pray while we were confined. And then God answered our prayers. I can tell you, God still answers prayer to this day. So today I can say we are emerging as a resounding miracle story. What many experts predicted that COVID-19 would do to us normally, it never really happened to us. We thank God for this. God has been sparing us ever since COVID-19 got here. And to date, the country has about 8,362 cases, of which 5,933 have been recovered, and we have only 214 deaths so far. And we thank God for this. And then I had no one in our church, in our church family, in our church affiliate, in the IFBC churches in Haiti, not even one person I know have been infected with the COVID-19. So we thank God for this. We are so grateful for what the Lord has done for us here in Haiti, because He knows that we will never be able to handle this crisis. So He did something that no one expected would happen in Haiti. So we're thankful for that. Now, as we navigate through this crisis, as we thinking about what's going on into the world and everywhere, I just want to share a thought with you. And this days remind me of the journey that Israel had to take to get into the promised land. And after Moses led the Israelites through the wilderness, and then Moses now died, and God has called Joshua to take over the leadership to get the Israelites to the promised land. But Joshua and the people came to the Jordan River, and they came to the Jordan River. They had to cross the Jordan River. But the difficulty is that Israel was facing a challenge, a very big challenge, and they had to cross the Jordan River. At the time, it was a flooding system. It was a flooding system. So Israel stood in front of the Jordan River, looking at the water gushing down with such a speed that it was ready to take with it anything that stands in its way. So what then shall Israel do? And we read the Lord's instructions to Joshua in Joshua chapter 3, verses 1 to 4, of which I am reading for you right now. Early in the morning, Joshua and all the Israelites set out from Shittim and went to the Jordan, where they camped before crossing over. After 3 days, the officers went throughout the camp, giving orders to the people. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, and the Levitical priests carrying it, you are to move out from your positions and follow it. Then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. Keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits between you and the Ark. Do not go near it. Israel had to move forward. The mission was not to stay in Jordan. The mission was to enter Canaan. But how do they get there? Which way do they go when there seems to be no way forward? Then came the instruction, move forward. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord and the priest carrying it moving, you have to move as well. This is it. We cannot stop doing what God calls us to do, even in such a time, because God never stops working. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has never been confined. While everything comes to a standstill, God is moving forward. There are lands to be conquered. There are people to be saved. There are people to be freed. The mission has not come to a halt. We still need to march on. We still need to go forward. We still need to keep moving in spite of everything that is challenging us. Well, some of us, in fact, a lot of us, do not want to move or start to move until we know for sure where we are going. This is somehow this is good. This is good. It is good to know where you are going. It is sometimes reassuring to know where to start and where to end. But at certain time, in special occasion like these days, we need to trust God to keep moving, even when visibility is very, very low. At times such as today, all we need to do is to follow the lead of the Lord. Be obedient to the call to move when the Spirit tells us to move. Even if it doesn't yet show us the way. Verse 4, give us hope. It says, then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. When you follow God, when you really follow God, you will know which way to go. We have never been this way before. Even so, we will not get lost, because the ark of the Lord is leading us. The Spirit of God is leading us today. This is a very important word for us today. We have never been this way before. COVID-19 is creating ways that we have never traveled before. I do not need to speak such words. COVID-19 changes almost everything in our lives. The family setting, the gathering, the church setting, and the community setting. Everything is being affected. Everything is being challenged. Our life is being disrupted, altered at every level. Everyone is a suspect of COVID-19, carrying this virus with you until you are proven innocent. Life is not the same. Some people think it will never be the same. We have never been this way before, but this should not keep us from moving forward, because the one who is leading us has been there. Brothers and sisters, let us keep doing what we are doing, what God has called us to do. Let us continue to be involved in mission. Let us continue to think about those in places who need our help, who need our support, who need our prayers, and who need us to back them up. And this is why I think today is a very important day in the life of the church. We have never been this way before, but the Lord is leading us. And the mission of God is continuing. God is moving. God is working. God never rests. And He is calling us to continue to do what He has called us to do. So this is it. And while I think that I have so much to do even in time like this, but God has been calling me to do more. And in July, I've been selected to be the president of IMES University of Haiti, an institution where I've been working for 12 years. And now, with a change in leadership, and God has placed me here to lead even in this challenging time. So what should I do? Should I sit and look at my journey to course? But I'm trusting the Lord to move forward. I've never been this way before in my life, but I'm trusting the Lord to move forward. I think this is the call for us to move forward, to go, and God will know, God will show us the way. He will tell us where to go. He will show us, He will lead us. So would you join Claudia and myself in prayer for our ministry, pray for our health, for our sanity, pray for the church. We've been confronted with some issue in our church with electricity. We had to buy a new generator, and that cost us $4,570, which, again, in such a time to raise and to get, and it's difficult. Pray for the call for my new appointment as the president of a big, a significant institution in Haiti. Pray that the Lord will show me which way to go, and pray for His provision in our life. Thank you so much for taking the time to hear me, and I pray that we will be together soon in person as the Lord wills. Thank you so much, church. Thank you so much, my friend, Pastor Lester and Sister Chris. Thank you so much for all of you. And may God continue to bless you, continue to keep you, and provide for all our needs as we moving forward with the mission of God. God bless you today.
From Lagos, Nigeria, West Africa. Greetings from my wife, Victoria, and our five children, our great children. Their names are Grace, Goodness, Esther, Blessing, only boy, Jeremiah. Grace is 23 years our eldest and is doing her master's degree right now, whereas our youngest, Jeremiah, is 15 years old. It is a great delight be part of your faith promise convention for this year. I do know that the pandemic has changed a lot of things for you and for us in different parts of the world, making even travel to be somewhat challenging. But we thank God so much for providing technology, that through technology, I am able to participate in this Faith Promise Convention. The last time, if I remember, I was here at your Faith Promise Convention, I think it was in 2017 or 2018, maybe Pastor Lester can I remember, because he and his wife, they hosted me there, and all of the good people there at Wayside really wish I could be there, you know, to see your faces. But it's a delight to be here. I just want to share briefly about what we continue to do. You know, for the past 6 years or so, my whole life has been in the ministry, and I'm very grateful to God that God continued to use common vessels like us, you know, to accomplish His purpose and His mission. Here in Lagos, Nigeria, there are three ministries that we are involved with. The first is the ministry of the International Fellowship of Bible Churches, which I believe, you know, you're part of that ministry. Myself, alongside with other elders here in Lagos, Nigeria, John Omuka and Pastor Joseph Chukuma, here in Lagos, we focus on planting churches. Secondly, we focus on working with ministers through our IFBC forum. And then, thirdly, we make sure that from time to time we organize informal conferences and seminars for pastors informally, you know, just to help with a lot of pastors who need training. And so that aspect of our ministry continue to be ongoing. The second aspect of our ministry here has to do with my work at Africa Center for Theological Studies, in short, ACTS. ACTS is a non-denominational seminary, and I am serving as IFBC missionary at Africa Center for Theological Studies. There, I serve as the Vice President for Academic Affairs. I supervise and administrate and develop academic programs for the institution. Secondly, I'm also a professor in the area of leadership mission and anthropology. So I teach, we have a bachelor's program, we have diploma level program, we have postgraduate diploma program, and then we have a master's program, a master's of divinity, a master of arts in Christian leadership, a postgraduate diploma in ministry and leadership, a master of arts in biblical and theological studies. And you ask, why should this engage my attention? Well, it's important because in my country, we have witnessed a significant growth of the church. But about 85% of our pastors have not had any kind of formal theological education. And so what that means is that these pastors, you know, they need training so that they can be effective in their ministry of preaching and discipling. So I count it to be a unique opportunity that I can impact one pastor, one of these pastors, pastor membership of 500 members, 1,000 members, 2,000, 3,000, some of them 5,000. So if this is a unique opportunity for me to be part of the process of molding these leaders. Some of them are from the northern part of Nigeria, which is an Islamic dominated area. So we train them for them to go back and do ministry among the Muslims. Some of them are from West African countries, from Sierra Leone, from Ghana, and all of these places. It's a delight, you know, to be involved, you know, with this. So it's a ministry that I am really passionate about, to see more leaders being trained, you know, for the continent of Africa. And I'm so glad that all the way in the U.S., you can be part of this ministry. You cannot come to Lagos, Nigeria, or any part of northern Nigeria, but you are able to resource me to be able to do our ministry. And I am so grateful. My wife and family, we are so grateful for this kind of very, very valuable support that you provide. The third aspect of our ministry, which is really directly supervised with my wife, and of course we do it together, is our ministry to teenagers in the high school. We started a school project known as Cedrela High School. Here in Nigeria, it is called Cedrela College, different as it is in the States, isn't it? But the ministry, which started not too long ago, we have about 40 girls and boys who come in every day to the school. One, it provides us opportunity to train these girls, because if you know the statistics from the United Nations Children Education Fund, almost four out of five teenagers in Nigeria, Lagos, you know, if you four out of five, they're out of school. So there are a lot of them that need this kind of training. We have to first of all bridge the gap of ignorance and make sure that these children are properly educated, because education open their mind and brings about some kind of liberation. But secondly, in Nigeria, we have the unique opportunity, without any restraint from the government, to be able to communicate the gospel, you know, to these children. So that is what we do. And God, you know, have been blessing this ministry. Let me close by drawing your attention that you have to keep us in your prayer. First of all, I want to encourage you to pray for the children at Cedrela College, pray for the faculty and staff at Africa Center for Theological Study. Third, pray for our IFBC elders and church planting and training we do, you know, among pastors here. I also want to encourage you to continue to give towards us. And as you do your faith promise convention, if you can increase your giving to us, we will greatly appreciate it, because it will go a long way, you know, to help us. I can't tell you how much, you know, cost of living and inflation has gone up in our country, but it will be appreciated. Secondly, you can sponsor a teenager at Cedrela College. With $150, you'll be able to sponsor a student for a year. That will provide tuition-free education for the student, because the school is located in a semi-slum area where the parents don't have enough to be able to get their children to school. Thirdly, you can also support pastor in training. I will send to Pastor Esther the details of that. It costs us about $500 to support a pastor, you know, in a year. And finally, I want to say that I am so grateful to Wayside Community Church, grateful to Pastor Lester and his wife, who hosted me when I was there last time, but also grateful to the elders and deacons and leaders in the church for this opportunity to participate, you know, in this faith promise convention. Hopefully the next time I'm in the state, I will be able to participate with you. But thank you so very much. God bless you, and God bless the ministry that you do there. Amen.
Gensen, at the end of his message, had mentioned that they had to replace a generator, and he said that was $4,570 that it costs. And I don't know if that's been all paid off yet or not. I don't think that it has been. And so he specifically mentioned that, and then he asked us to pray for the churches there. I think Levy mentioned that there were 15 pastors and smaller churches that he helps oversee in Haiti. The church that he helped plant several years ago, I forget how long it's been now, 5 or 6 years ago perhaps, runs about 200 to 300 people every Sunday. And then there's these other churches that have been started, and God is really blessing them there. Going just a couple of things just to make sure you got what William was saying there in Nigeria. It was hard, I acknowledge it was hard sometimes to understand and get the words. The five children that he said, his wife is Victoria and his five children are Grace, goodness, Esther, mercy, and Jeremiah. Grace, their oldest one, is here in the States now working on her master's degree. And I think I read somewhere just recently, she hopes someday to be possibly an ambassador for Nigeria to the UN. So that's her long-range goal, one of them. The ministries he mentioned, he's involved with the Fellowship of Bible Churches and church planting, starting up new churches there, training pastors and working with those in Nigeria. He's also involved in Africa Center for Theological Studies. He's a vice president for academic affairs and also a professor and teaching. He mentions how that there's really an explosion of evangelism and revival in Nigeria. The church has grown exponentially, but hardly any of the pastors have formal education. And so one of their projects, one of their things that they try to do is provide opportunities for pastors to be trained. And then the third ministry, if you caught that, he was saying him and his wife have started this ministry with teenagers. Over there they call it a high school, or call it a college, but it's the equivalent of high school here in the States, and they have 40 girls and boys right now that they're working with and providing an education for them. And so at the end there, he was asking about support, if we were able or anyone was interested. One of the teenagers in that school that they're doing can be sponsored for $150 for the whole year, which sounds unbelievable to us here, but that was what he said. And then the pastor training, they have pastors that are still in training and yet they're already pastoring. And he said that support for a pastor could be done with $300 for a whole year. That would take care of it. And so just want to finish up with some slides real quickly here to explain what our church has done. I try to do this every year to help us see what Wayside has been able to do for the past 12 months. And this will be a rundown, a summary of what we've been able to do and support for missionary work over the last 12 months. Good grief. My button got stuck, I guess. Francis, could you go in there and start that slideshow again? Probably. Actually, just close it down. We're running out of time, and I can go through it quicker. The good thing about technology is that it's not a good thing sometimes. Here are the international ministries that we've supported throughout this last year. Gideon's International, which is a Bible distribution. International Fellowship of Bible Churches, which has works in all different kinds of areas of the world. Here's just a summary. Philippines, Africa, including Sierra Leone and Nigeria. We have works in India, Pakistan. This year, I don't know how many of you remember this or knew this, but we do send, I think it's $50 a month of support towards Dr. Udotong, and that goes every month. And then we also have money that goes through our church. I think it's just an individual at this point that channels their contribution through our church to go to Duncan Pryor and his wife, Elaine, were here not too long ago, last year, I think, for working among people in Mexico. And then we supported Mercy Ships. Randy Shaw was here last year, I think, at this time. And he works with Mercy Ships, which is a hospital ship that goes to different parts of the world to provide surgeries and medical treatment. One Mission Society, we this year in relation to One Mission Society, we had back in February, Sadie Sprankel has worked and planning to go back to work in Hungary. We had Tim Bell here, who is a coordinator for the missionaries getting into different churches to speak. Then we, Project Liberty is the orphanage in Mozambique with Jennifer Justice Chana, and we send money there every quarter, I believe. We supported Samaritan's Purse with the Operation Christmas Child. We supported Voice of the Martyrs, which is a worldwide organization primarily focusing on Christians that are persecuted, helping those that are persecuted for their faith. We do what we call the birthday offering for Jesus every year at Christmas. And I think we sent over $2,000 last year for that. Then World Gospel Mission. And we've had a number of different missionaries over the years that are affiliated with World Gospel Mission. This year it was Mike and Donna Brown who were here in March. So the total that we gave in the last 12 months for international ministries was $22,018. So we thank the Lord for that. Then in local ministries here in the United States, we have the Alpha Omega Pregnancy Center in Slippery Rock and Newcastle. Christian Assistance Network is right here in Grove City, and it helps local families with a number of different kinds of needs, from rent to putting a roof on their house or whatever might be needed. The Grove City Ministerial Association helps out providing lodging and food and gas when needed by any transients that are passing through, and it's a program that they've had for several years so that people wouldn't just go from church to church to church and get all that they can. This is a cooperative effort to help with that. They also have a fund that helps people in times of homelessness or transition between instability housing. Then the Grove City Food Pantry, the Mercer Food Pantry, the International Fellowship of Bible Churches, again, local U.S. ministries. There's a MMS Aviation over in Coshocton, Ohio. That is where Ben and Bobby Kay's granddaughter, Rebecca, is studying right now and learning to be an airplane mechanic, and eventually plans to go back to Alaska and minister there. So all of those areas that we've mentioned, as well as Newcastle Rescue Mission, New Destiny Treatment Center, Project Restore is a ministry in Greenville that works with children that have been rescued from human trafficking. Reaching Up and Reaching Out is a ministry to women that are coming out of prison who need housing, transitional housing, and they do Celebrate Recovery with them. And then Salvation Army. We've given support to all of those different local and U.S. ministries, so that the total for local ministries, $16,550. And then we have another category that we just call local benevolence, where our church has just personally from us helped out families with different kinds of needs and medical bills, utility bills, or whatever the crisis might be. and that was over $900. So our total giving for missions type work in the last 12 months was $39,476, which I think is very good for a church our size. And so the faith promise offering, the cards that are in the bulletin today, I'd like you to take those and fill them out if you would. We're going to collect them. On the card, you have the opportunity to make a commitment weekly, so much per week, and then you can total that up what it would be for the whole year. Or you can designate a certain amount per month and then total what that would be for the year. Or you can just designate a one-time gift, just a lump sum of whatever amount, any amount, and that would go on the bottom option. And your name is optional. You don't have to put your name on it. And you can put today's date. That'll help us know that it is for this year. And so I'd like for you to do that. And if Tim or somebody could check out in the parking lot for those that are out there in the cars that would want to turn in a card, we'll collect those. Mike, would you mind just stepping in and just walk around, and when you have your card done, if you'll lift it up, Mike will come by and pick those up. I want to real quickly here, our time is gone, but I want to real quickly go down through and just read what we are designating today. There will be more. We'll keep receiving these for a few weeks. But last year, on Faith Promise Sunday, our total amount pledged was $25,304, I believe, was the total, $25,304. And I know that, that this has been a difficult year, but I'd like to see our church reach that 25,000 mark again, if possible, and see how we can do. When you get all of those, Mike, if you wanted to bring them up here, I'll read them off. And I asked Marge if she would just run the calculator for us this morning, and we'll try to get you a total for today. Now, as I said, thank you. There will be more that will come in the coming weeks, but and we'll keep you updated each week in the bulletin. Okay, Marge, if you're ready. Okay, I told her I'd go slow so she wouldn't get overwhelmed. All right, 500, 1200, 360, 1000, 1300, 200, 600, 510, 780, 600, 240, 480, 600, 20. Ten, 360, 1800, 520, 500, 20. 100, 520, and 150.
$12,370.
$12,370?
Yes.
Okay. Praise the Lord. Very good. I want to thank you for your participation. And I know it was a little difficult today being able to understand everything on the videos. It would have been easier if they were here in person, I know. But it still gave us a little bit of an international flavor, I think, today. And just a reminder of what an awesome job that we have to continue spreading the gospel and building the kingdom of God around the world. And we certainly thank the Lord for those that are out on the front lines, you might say, and involved in that vital work in the kingdom of God. So we will continue to accept the card. Probably we'll probably have them in the bulletin again one more Sunday, and then after that we'll just have them on the table for a couple of Sundays perhaps. I know last year we continued to have some trickle in for at least 3 weeks, so I don't know what our total will end up being this year, but we're off to a good start. And we just thank the Lord for your faithfulness and for your commitment. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you would, for a closing prayer. And again, I want to thank you for being here today. Our Father, we thank you for what we've heard today. Thank you for William and for Jensen and the ministries that they are involved in, and how you have used them in so many different ways and so much vital work for the kingdom of God. And Lord, I just pray that you would remember them and all of the others that we have supported over the months in the past, and we pray that even today you would bless them and help them in their work and efforts to spread the gospel of Jesus and to bring more and more people into the kingdom of God and get them ready for heaven. We pray that you would help us to realize our responsibility, Lord, not only to help financially support the work of missions around the world, but our responsibility to spread the gospel where we are and to have an impact for your kingdom wherever you send us, Lord. And as we are reminded of the words that Jensen shared with us, that God will go forward, God will go before us and will lead the way and show us the way we should go, because we haven't been this way before. We just trust you today. Bless each and every one of us, Lord, and use us throughout this day for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. The Lord bless you.